Hi, in this video, I'm going to talk about the panel data analysis. Alright, so as part of this session, I'm going to cover the following topics. I'll talk about the panel data, what is panel data, and then I'll talk about how to analyze panel data. And then I'll talk about the estimation techniques used in panel data analysis. I'll then talk about the LM test, Hausmann test. You know, we'll get in the details of these tests. So I'll explain the concepts by taking a case study, and then you know, finally I'll conclude about the analysis. So let's get started. So let's first understand what is panel data. You might have heard about time series data and cross-section data. So let me give examples of time series data and cross-section data. The time series data looks like this. You have got the stock price of a particular stock over a period of time. Continuous period of time. So you have got stock price for 1st December, for 2nd December, 3rd December, and 4th of December. So you have stock price data for 4 consecutive days. So that's time series because it has data for different time periods. And you know, the difference between the consecutive time period is constant because it is only 1 day difference data, right? So this is called time series data. So what is cross-section data? In cross-section data, you won't have the time component. So here is an example. We have got data for different cities in United States for a particular year. Let's say the year is 2014. So for 2014, we have got data for 3 cities, Florida, California, and New York. We have got the population in millions, average income, percentage educated, and then the rainfall. Okay, so I've got data for different cities for a single time period, and that's important. Single time period. Okay. So in cross-section data, you will have data for different cross-sections only for a one time period. Okay. Whereas in time series, you have only one, kind of data. For instance, here we have the stock price, but for different time periods. So that's the difference between time series and cross-section data. Now, what is panel data? Well, panel data is just some kind of a combination. The way, if you combine time series aspect and the cross-section aspect of data, then we get a panel data. So let's take an example to understand. So here is an example. So remember in the last slide, we talked about a data set which has got information about different cities in United States. So we've got data for Florida, California, and New York. So we've got data for population, average income, percentage educated, rainfall, and we have got another column here, which is time. Remember in the previous slide, we talked about the cross-section data, which has got data for only 2014. But here, we have got the same data for 2015 as well. Now here, we have data for 2 years. Okay, 2 years. Or in general, we have got data for multiple years, okay, or more than 1 year. So in that case, we call this as a panel data because we have got cross-section data for multiple years. Now, this is our cross-section data. So this is the data that we had in the previous slide. So this is the cross-section and this gets repeated for 2015 as well, and you can extend to 2016 and so on. You can also go, you know, go to 2013, 12, 11, and 10, and that is panel data for the three different cities. Now, what is the main feature of panel data? Well, the main feature of panel data is that it has got cross-section component and it has also got time series component. The same cross-section gets repeated over time. Okay, the values will of course change, but the same cross-section. So we have got three cities, right? So we have got data for the same three cities for the next year as well. So it combines both cross-section and time series, is known as panel data. So we learn about analyzing such a data and how it is different from cross-section. Why can't we use the cross-section techniques used for cross-section data analysis in panel data analysis in detail. So please be with us. Okay, let's move on. Panel data can be categorized into two types. One is balanced panel data and the other one is unbalanced panel data. So what is a balanced panel data? If you look at the right hand side of the data set, so this one. So this is the one that we have taken from the previous slide. Okay, so this is called balanced panel. Why? Because we have got data for the three cross sections and then we have got data for exactly the three cross sections without missing out on any one of them. But what if we miss out on just, you know, at least one of them? Then that becomes unbalanced panel data. If you look at the left hand side of the data, you see that we have got data for Florida, California, but the data for Newark is missing. Whereas we have got the data for Newark for 2015, but for 2014, the data for Newark is missing. So this is called unbalanced, where you know you have different cross section. It's not the same set of cross sections which are getting repeated for the next year. It is a different set of cross section which is there for the next year. So if any one of these is missing, which often happens in panel data analysis, where you know we could come across cases where we have got missing data, that becomes unbalanced panel data. And the analysis used for balance and unbalanced panel data is different in some sense. In this particular session, we'll talk mostly about the balanced panel data. So what are the important features of panel data which makes it different from the ordinary data or data which is not panel data, you know, for instance of the cross-section data? Well, the panel data allows the control over variables we cannot observe or measure. Okay, and we'll understand this. So what is that we cannot observe, okay, in great detail? So what happens is that in panel data, if you take the example from the previous slide, we have got population for a particular city, let's say Florida. Okay, so we have got 10 million and then the next year the population for Florida is 12 million. So not only we are having the data for Florida for a particular year, we are having it for different years. So we know the trend that is there in this particular data. So we have two advantages of having panel data. We have got trend, okay, within the variable, okay, and we have also got variation across variables. Okay, so that is a combination of the features of panel, the features of cross-section and time series, and that makes it interesting to analyze. And some of the aspects of research require your data to be, you know, time variant and at the same time you know, having you know, some sort of cross-section features as well. Some of the unobserved you know, components which do not get captured in cross-section analysis are like the examples like culture and ethical. Okay, now for instance, if you are doing analysis of a population data, if you're doing an analysis of a population data for a particular particular year, let's say 2014, you wouldn't be able to find out how, you know, a certain aspect of the population is changing over time. Okay, for instance, the cultural aspect, the ethical aspect. You know, if you do an analysis for 20 years, let's say you're doing an analysis from 85 to 2000, you know, 15, so you're doing analysis for 30 years, a lot of things would have changed about the population. People aren't the same what they used to be 30 years ago. So there are certain aspects of the population that changes over time. Okay, so that can only be captured in a panel data analysis and not in a cross-section data analysis. And that's one of the important features of panel data. It also accounts for the individual heterogeneity. Okay, that means how within the individual you know, things change. For instance, how you know, the population is changing over time for Florida and how it is changing for New York. Okay, so one can compare how Florida is, you know, the certain you know, certain feature of the state Florida is changing over time compared to New York. So the comparison is also possible in panel data. How do we analyze panel data? Okay, is it the same that we normally use for cross section? So important thing is that it has got both the features, time series and cross section. So the question here is, can we use the ordinary least square? Can we use the OLS? Okay, and what are the problems that one might face by applying the ordinary least square regression in doing the analysis? Okay, now there is going to be problems. Okay, there are problems using OLS in panel data analysis. Okay, not always though, but there are instances where you will have problems. And one of the main reason why you will have problems is because, you know, you will have correlated errors. We'll talk about it. And you know, when there are correlated error terms. Okay, now you might wonder why the errors are correlated in panel data. We'll talk about it. Okay, if they're correlated errors, then this will violate some of the assumption of OLS, and you know, that's something to be taken care very you know, very carefully. Otherwise, there is going to be issue. A typical OLS model looks something like this: yi is equal to, you know, the estimates a plus b xi plus error term. Whereas a model form for panel data looks like this: yit. So the extra component or the extra thing here is the time component. So I stands for the cross section, T stands for the time series. So it's got both the components, right? For instance, in our example, I stands for here the cities, New York, Florida, and so on, and time stands for different time period, 2014, 2015, and so on. Okay. Now, in this particular case, you will see that the errors will most likely to be correlated for a particular cross section. If you take the population for Florida over time, over 2014, 2015, 2016, and you know, even before that, you'll most likely find the population to be very correlated among themselves, right? Hence, the error term are also most likely to be correlated, and that is an issue in OLS. Okay, so either that has to be corrected before using OLS, or you can use alternative technique. We'll see how we can deal with this problem and how we can overcome this problem while doing panel data analysis. And yes, so for that we'll take a case. We'll take a simple case. So what we're trying to do here is we're trying to predict We are trying to rather understand the relationship between the salaries of employees with different covariates or different independent variables. Okay, the independent variables are the experience of the employee, the projects, the number of projects that the employee has taken up in his career, and the education, number of years of education the employee has. Now these are the three covariates, and we have got the logarithm of salary as the dependent variable. So this is the dependent variable, and the independent variables are experience, projects, and education. Okay, so we will have a model like this, right? There will be three estimates, and we have the experience, then projects, and then education. Okay, all right, so the model will look like this. Now question is, why do we take a logarithm of salary instead of salary? Well, in some research people take logarithm of certain variables so as to have a better model, and one of the reason they take is to reduce the variance. That's one of the reason, and there are other reasons as well. Okay, so we have taken the logarithm of salary as the dependent variable, and we've got three independent variables. So this data is available for different time periods. Okay, and we have got different employees. So for employee ID 1, we have got data for 7 years, right? If you look at this data, employee ID 1, we have got data for time point 1, time point 2, time point 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. So for seven consecutive years, we have got the data for the employee. All right. Now, how do we build a model? Okay, remember the model that we are trying to build here. We are trying to have a regression model which explains that explains the relationship between the factors like experience, number of projects, and number of years of education with salary. So what we're trying to know here is the marginal effect, like how experience impact the salary of someone. We're also trying to know the relationship in terms of the sign, whether it has a positive effect or negative effect, and so on. Pretty much similar to the multiple linear regression, just that the structure of the data is different in this case. So how do we fit a regression model to this? We'll use the panel data analysis instead of the least square analysis, and we'll take a certain aspect of least square analysis as well, and we'll use R to analyze the data or to fit the model. Okay, in R you have got the panel data model, PLM. So I'll show you the code, I'll give you the code, you can use the code, and you can run the analysis by yourself. There are different analysis one can try out in this case. Okay, one of the analysis is pooled OLS regression. It's one form of regression, OLS regression, that you can use instead of panel data. Okay, the reason why we are trying OLS regression is to show you the weakness of this technique. Okay, weakness. Also to show you that why this particular technique is not very suitable for this type of data set, right? And that will ensure that we have a strong argument for going in for a panel data analysis. So just to show you how to use a pooled OLS regression. So the estimation happens to ordinary least square, and the analysis is pretty similar to cross section. Now if you just ignore the time series component and use the cross section, what problem one might face we'll see here. And what is the form of this particular pooled regression? Well, it assumes uniform error variance, right? So you will have, you know, if you have like, let's say we have got two cross sections, okay, group one and group two. Okay, so the only thing that is uniform in these two groups is the variance of the error. Okay, so the error variance is constant, that is what is assumed. So we will not get into details of it, details of how pool oil regression is why it is pool OLS regression and how it is different from the OLS regression. You can read more about it, but we'll be using pool OLS regression in this case. So only thing you need to remember here is that the error variance is uniform across different cross section. Okay, so that is one assumption in pooled OLS regression, and we'll use this in this data. So how do we use this? We use the PLM, and then we have got the dependent, and we have got the independent. So we have just coded this. So in independent, you have the three independent variables, right? We saw in the data set. We have got the data, input data, the same data that I showed you. And in the model, you have to put it in the kind of model that you are using. Okay. So we are using pooling in this case. So just provide pooling to this particular statement, and we are saving this in a variable called pool. So this is the syntax. Okay, simple syntax, and if you're familiar with R, you should find it very easy. Okay, so we're just taking a procedure PLM which takes argument which has independent variable, variables, dependent variable, the data, and the type of model that we are trying to panel data models that we are trying to fit here. So we'll see some of the statistics in this particular result. So in the results, we have got the intercept and the slope coefficients, the R square and the adjusted R square. Remember, this is OLS, so we'll of course get these things in the results. So what we can see here is that two of the variables are significant. Okay, experience is significant because it's less than 0.05. similarly, education is also significant. Number of projects is not a significant variable in determining the salary of an employee. The R square is 0.35 and the adjusted R square is also pretty much the same. So that's what result from this particular model. Now, is it good? No, it is not good model because it's a bad fit to the data. Okay, we can actually have a better model. We can actually have a better model with higher R square. Okay, with higher R square. Which signifies the model strength. Okay, R square, the higher it is, the better it is, right? We want always very high R square. We want always it to go up. So it ignores the fact that it is a panel data. It's simply we are fitting a cross section model to a panel data. So of course we will expect a not so good model, and that's exactly what we're getting here. We are getting only 35% of R square, which is not a very good fit to the data. And this is happening because the error terms are correlated and we are not taking care of that. Okay, so we are losing out a lot of information in this particular type of model. Okay, the next one that we're going to do is the between estimation. So this is the estimation type 2. Okay, pooled one is 1 and this is 2, the second type. So what it does is it calculates the average of the dependent and the independent variable over time and does the OLS regression of the of the dependent by taking the independent variables. It's pretty simple. So what it does is we have got time series as well as cross extended, right? When we do the average, if you take the average over time, so you'll only get the cross section, right? What do you do? You simply take the average over time. You have got 7 period, right? 1 to 7th. So you take the average of education, the average of the number of projects, the average of the third variable as well. Okay. And if you do that, the time series component is gone now. Now you don't have data for all 7 years. You just have data for the average of the 7 years. So we are now have, if you do that, we do not have to deal with time series. We just have to deal with the cross section. And that is also going to be an issue. But I'm just showing you an alternative technique. Like what are the options that you want? Even if you use between estimation, it is not going to be optimal in nature. It might be a little better than the pooled Euler's regression, but may not be the most optimal one. Okay. So the syntax remains same, except the fact that in the model statement, we are using between instead of the pooled that we had used last time. The results are pretty much same, except the fact that the R square has gone up now. R square has 0.4 instead of 0.35 the last time we saw. Now, as I was initially, I was talking to you in the last slide that the R square might go up, but we are not sure if this model is the optimal fit. And it has certainly gone up, but it is definitely not the optimal one. It can go up even higher if we use a right model. Okay, so the between estimation is also not a fit to this data. One thing you need to remember here, probably you have to revisit the theory, and I strongly recommend you to learn the pooled estimation and the combined estimation, ordinary least square, pooled and combined ordinary OLS estimation. You should go through the theory to understand this particular this better, because I'm not able to cover like every single thing in this particular video, because the the main purpose of this video is to learn panel data, not the OLS one. So I'm just talking in brief about this estimation, but you can always go through the theory to get a better understanding. So in combined estimation, all we are doing is we're just averaging it out over time. Okay, so we have got education. Let's for example, we have got education, number of education for education of course will not change. Let's take one data. Okay, let's say experience, right? So experience is changing over time. So this is the experience for the first individual, right? We're just taking the average of that in between estimation. Similarly, the number of projects, we're also taking the average of that. Okay, so when you take the average of that, all these 7 observations, you will only get a 1 value, right? So the data will be will not have any time series component, and that's exactly what happens in between estimation. In pool estimation, we don't do that. We still have the all the 7 observations, but in between we only have the average of the 7. That's why we have got rid on of the time series component. What is the next one? The next one is the first difference estimation. In this particular type of estimation, we exploit some feature of the panel data. Okay, so what we do is that we take the first difference of the two equations for different time periods. If you know, in time series we've got the lags, right? So if XT is known as the data for the current time, XT minus 1 is known as the data for the lag period. Similarly, xt minus 2 is the data for the next lag period, right? So this is how we represent a time series data. If you're familiar with time series, this is pretty easy for you. If you're not, so this is how we represent the time series data. So we've got two types of equations here, two equations rather, yit and yit minus 1. So this is for the lag period. Okay, similarly, for the independent variables, we have got xit and xit minus 1. Ci is an individual effect, okay? Individual effect as in the effect that is purely for different individuals, okay? In this example, we have got the data for, the employees, right? We have got data for the employee. Now, we have got data for education, then projects, and then what else? The education, projects, what was the last one? Okay, the third variable, right? And apart from the three variables, there are other things about a particular employee that also matters, right? For instance, the IQ level, right? So if you compare two employees with same education, same years of experience, same number of project, you still find a difference in the salary. That could be because of the IQ level of two employees. Okay, so that could be one thing. The university or the school that a person attended, that also could matter, right? University also could matter. Then family background, parents' income, right? That also could matter for the salary of an employee, right? Somebody who has gone to a better school or a better university, whose parents have been able to spend more money or more time for the for a particular employee, then there is a higher likelihood, the likelihood that he would have been able to more successful in his profession would have been higher, right? So given these three variables same, you will still find the difference in the salary for two persons, and these are individual specific things, okay? Individual specific things, or also we call it as the unobserved variables or unobserved features of the data. Remember in the first slide for final data, we talked about the unobserved things, and I had told that time that I'll be talking about in detail. So this is exactly what it is. Now we capture that in a variable called CI. I stands for the cross section because that doesn't change over time. Also, that's an assumption here. So we just see that, you know, the unobserved thing is very specific for a particular employee. So it could be C1, C2, and C3 for employee number 1, employee number 2, and employee number 3. And they will, of course, differ among them. Okay. So that component is captured in CI. When you take first difference, what is first difference? You just simply subtract the lag from the original variable. So if we take yt minus 1, we essentially call it as first difference, okay? And then we take yt, and you can go on, you can take second difference, third difference, and so on, but this is first difference. And we do the regression by taking the first difference, and that's why it is called first difference estimation. So essentially what we are doing here is that we are taking the first difference here. So in the left hand side, we'll of course we'll have something like this, plus you have got beta 1 x1 it, then beta 2 xit minus 1 plus ci minus ci. Remember, the unobserved factor gets cancelled out in this case. and then you have the error term and so on. Now that's interesting. When you take the first difference, you actually get rid of the unobserved impact or the individual specific effect on the dependent variable. And technically we call that as individual heterogeneity. Okay, which essentially means the variation or the effect of unobserved things on dependent variables. We technically call it as individual heterogeneity is eliminated from the model by taking the first difference. When we run this particular type of regression by taking the first difference, by getting rid of the individual effect, syntax remains same except the fact that in the statement model you are just using FD. So what are we getting here? We are just getting one significant variable, okay, and that is projects. Okay, so education and number of years of experience hasn't been significant. Now that's a little strange. Okay, so what about the R square? The R square is extremely low. Okay, now we are getting two strange events. One, that two important variables, education and number of years of experience, are coming out to be insignificant. So that's strange, because you wouldn't expect these variables to be insignificant in such cases. Why? Because these are very important in determining salary. So that's common sense, right? And R square is also pretty less, 0.007. That's like less than 1%. That's totally strange, and this result is unacceptable. So you've seen education got dropped, because education doesn't change over time, right? So it's totally got dropped, right? Number of your experience is coming out to be insignificant. So this model is also not so very good. Okay. In fact, not at all good. This is totally giving a very weird results. The next type of model that we'll talk about, and this is the pure panel data model, so to say. Okay. One is the fixed effect model, or we call it as fixed effect panel data model. Okay, popular ones, fixed effect panel data model. So what it does is it treats the unobserved individual heterogeneity. We talked about unobserved individual heterogeneity in the last slide, right? And when it denoting is alpha I, so we had denoted as CI. Let's not confuse with the notations. The same, right? We're just changing notations, okay? So it's alpha I in this case. So we'll not confuse it with the alpha I, which is the intercept here, right? So let's not confuse with that. We'll keep on using alpha I for the individual heterogeneity. So we assume here is that the unobserved heterogeneity for each employee to be correlated with the explanatory variable or the independent variables. Okay, so that's an assumption. So we say that alpha I is very correlated with xi or xit. Okay, so the correlation between alpha I, which is the individual heterogeneity, is with the independent variables is non-zero. Now this is an assumption. Okay, if this happens, we'll be using fixed effect model. Now the obvious questions is like, how do you know this is there, right? We'll see. How do we know that this is zero or non-zero, and what if it is zero? Okay, we'll see that later. So the estimation involves transformation to remove the unobserved effect, pretty much like the first difference estimation type. Here also we are going to get rid of the alpha I term, the unobserved effect, before doing the estimation. But there are other things as well. We'll not get into the details of the theory. You can always get into the details of the theory on your own. Since this is an introduction, I'll show more about the application of these things, and I'll talk briefly about the theory. Of course, this is very complicated theoretical topic, which needs to be studied in great detail. I'm just giving you an introduction. So fixed effect transformation will look something like this. The original model is YIT, and then we have got the unobserved effect. Let's ignore the intercept for the moment, and then we have got the slope coefficient beta, and then we have got independent variables and the error term. When we average it, right, average it over time, we'll get rid of time component, right? I have told you previously also, if you have data for time t1, t2, t3 up to t7, you average it, you get only one value, right? And that doesn't have time, right? So yt minus 1 yt minus 2, it could be 1 to minus 7, because they've got 7 data points for 7 time periods. If you average, take the average, you will have only one data, right? Y bar, which denotes the average, and it doesn't have T component. It only has the cross section component I. So we have averaged it out over time. Now we subtract. Okay. Now we subtract these two equations. So the initial, the first equation, and the second one, which is the average of the first equation. Okay. Remember the difference. The difference is that here we have only cross section, because it's average over time. So I've got rid of the time component, and here it has pure panel data. Okay, so when you take the difference of that, you will get certain kind of equation which is used for fixed effect estimation. Okay, the interesting thing is that when you take the difference, the unobserved effect alpha I will get cancelled, right? When you take the difference, it is going to be 0. Alpha I minus alpha I is 0, of course. So that is totally out of the equations. Now the estimation will be possible. So we're getting rid of by eliminating the alpha I in this case. And the LH side is known as the time demeaned Y. Okay, so these are technical terms that you need to remember. Time demeaned, nothing but getting rid of time. So technically we call it as time demeaned. Similarly, we're also getting rid of time demean, or we are having time demean x values, independent variables, as well as the error term. Now let's apply this concept to our case study, right? That one that we have taken. Now, on the time demeaned data, we can actually use the OLS regression. Okay. Why? Because when you have time demeaned data, your errors will not be correlated over time, because you have only cross section error I, J, K, and so on. So you don't have error like UIT, JT, and then UIT minus 1, UJT minus 1. So we expect these to be correlated, because there is a time component over time, right? Like the salary of the same person over time, okay? Salary of the person 1, okay? Person 1 for time 1, and salary of the same person in time 2 will most likely to be correlated. Now, since we have got rid of the time component, that thing is not going to be there. So errors are not going to be correlated over in this particular case. So we can use OLS now. So by doing this transformation and using OLS, we are estimating the equation. So this is all theory, right? So just for your understanding how fixed effect estimation is done, this is a broad overview of fixed effect estimation. I recommend you to study more about it, to understand more about it, how it is different from the ordinary least square estimation, how the transformation is actually helping us using ordinary least square estimation while doing the fixed effect estimation model. So let's use it in, for our data set. Syntax remains same that we have been using so far. The model type is now within. Now the fixed effect is also known as within effect. Okay. So fixed effect is same as within effect. Okay. So let's not get confused in this case. Let's look at the results. Now, in the results, we can see that there are two important variables which are significant. One is experience, the other one is projects. As expected, right, these two are very important variables for somebody's salary, right? So they're coming out of a significant. What about the R-square? Now, the R-square is 0.65. Adjusted R-square is 0.56. Now, that is significantly higher than the R-squares that we have seen in the previous three models, right? Why it is so? Because now we are using the correct methodology, right? So if you use the right estimation technique, the right model for the data, we'll have a better R-square, a better fit rather. Okay, so this is a better fit to the data. Previously, we were not using, we were using the wrong models for panel data. So we weren't using panel data model. So this is the panel data model, and that's why we have got the better result. The reason, I mean, if when you are doing in practice, you need not have to try, you know, all three types of estimation that I showed you in the beginning. The reason I showed you is to give a comparison study, a comparative reason study as to how OLS is different from the panel data analysis, and how we can actually empirically show that the panel data models are better fit to the panel data than the OLS models. So how do we interpret? Now education is dropped, that is fine, because education doesn't change over time. When we have taken the average, of course it is not going to be there, because education doesn't change over time for a particular portion, most likely, so it gets dropped. Experience has a positive effect on log salary, and the R square value is pretty good, so that shows that it's a good model. The next one and the last estimation technique that we'll be using, which is always compared with the fixed effect model, is the random effect estimation. And in panel data analysis, you will always be trying either fixed data estimation, fixed effect estimation, or random effect estimation. Now, the fundamental difference between the fixed effect estimation and random effect estimation is that it assumes that the individual specific effects, the unobserved effects, I'm talking about the alpha i's, are independent of the regressor. Okay, or the correlation between alpha I and xi is zero. In fixed effect, we had non-zero value. In random effect, it is zero. So that's the fundamental difference between a random effect estimation and the fixed effect and estimation. Okay. Other than that, there are other fundamental differences as well, especially doing the inference, whether it's doing the inference for population statistics, and there will be several questions related to when to use random effect and when to use fixed effect, and it's an important one. And in the last part of this presentation, I'll talk about how to decide which one is better, right? Fundamentally, we know the assumptions are different, but how do we know that the there exists correlation between the alpha I and xi? Do you have to do it first before deciding on which one is to be used? We'll see that. So let's use this first. We use the the statement model equal to random in this case. The rest of the syntax remains same, and where we're getting here is that experience is significant, education is also significant, but the R square value is going down. Yeah, it's 42% now. So previously we used to have 65%, it has gone down. But just by looking at the R square, we cannot say that which one is the best model, because best model for this particular data, we have to verify it statistically. So now we have come down to two models. One is fixed effect model and the one is random effect model, and we'll see which one is most suitable for our data, which one fits our data the best. Okay, for that we'll do the LM test. So LM test is used to decide whether you should you know, your data fits random effects versus the OLS. Okay, you might wonder that we are confused about random effect and fixed effect. Where we testing with respect to OLS? We'll see that. Okay, so let's just bear with you know, a few more slides. We'll have everything in place. So listen to me, just you know, few more minutes, and everything will be clear. So the LM is used to decide between random effect regression and a simple ordinary least square regression. Okay, and we'll be using the PLM test function in order to do that. The null hypothesis is that there is no significant difference across the cross-section unit. Okay, so that's the null hypothesis, which implies that the random effect model is inappropriate. So if we are in favor of null hypothesis, then random effect is inappropriate. If we're not in favor of null hypothesis, we're in favor of alternative hypothesis, then we will see that random effect is appropriate. Okay, when we do this, so pool is the result that we have used previously, right? So we just use that, and we're using the function PLM test. So what we're getting here is that the p value is significant. What does that mean? So that means that the null hypothesis is not in favor of the OLS. So what we can infer from this is that, given the fact that the p-value is less than 0.05, that means, you know, it gives us some kind of a significance. So null hypothesis, you know, the importance of null hypothesis, you know, gives us the confidence that random effect model is better against OLS. Okay, so we'll go ahead with random effect model. Similarly, we can do the LM test to choose between the fixed effect model and the OLS. So previously we did a comparison, we did a test to see if fixed random effect is better than OLS. We'll see that for fixed effect as well. Okay, so when we do that, the p-value is less than 0.05, is significant. So we are sure that the fixed effect model is performing better than the OLS. Okay, now the question is, we have found that random effect is also better than OLS. How do we decide between fixed effect and random effect? Now we know that these two tests are better than OLS. Now we have to select one of them. So we use the Hausmann test to select between fixed effect and random effects. Now this is done using PH test, a panel Hausmann test function. So you have the both the components, random and fixed, and we use the PH test function to do that. P is significant again, right? P is less than 0.05. Alright, so what it says is that as the null is rejected, the fixed effect method is chosen to model the data instead of the random effect model. Okay, now fixed effect is chosen. Now if p value would have been greater than 0.05, okay, then we'd have gone for random effect. But since p is less than 0.05, we're going for fixed effect. Now that's one thing, that's one rule of thumb that one has to remember all the times while, you know, using panel data models. We have also seen empirically that the R square value for fixed effect is the highest, right? It's 0.65 as compared to 0.42 for random effects. That also had given us an some kind of an indication, but it's always good to do a statistical test in order to find the best fit model. So I'll conclude the panel data analysis like this. I've already talked a lot about this. Just to summarize, panel data modeling is a method to estimate data which is both time series and cross sectional. I've talked many times. Just remember, it has both time series and cross sectional component. It is crucial to study the same cross sectional unit form. It could be form, it could be country, it could be an individual, an industry over a period of time. Now that feature is only available with panel data, not with time series data, not with cross section data. So how your cross sections like firm, like country, like an individual, industry is changing over time is something that can only be studied using panel data analysis. And the last thing, or the important thing, is it accounts for the individual specific heterogeneity, something that is not a feature of cross section, right? It is not a feature of cross section, whereas it is a feature of panel data analysis. So if some of your variables are missing from a cross section analysis, we come across a case known as the omitted variable bias. Omitted variable bias, right? Whereas in panel data analysis, this is part of the analysis. So individual specific heterogeneity across time is something that is there in the analysis. So where are the applications of panel data analysis? We'll find application of panel data analysis in most of the social science and business research. It could be educational research, wherein we are trying to find out the performance of students across schools, for different years. Clinical research, for clinical trials and so on. For a given drugs over a period of time, it could be biological research and so on. Financial research, performance of stocks, different stocks for different period of times. So we have different types of stock, different companies. At the same time, we have got data for different years. It could be different companies and their different financial ratios, financial performance indicators and so on for different periods. And this is very important. In financial research, you have got data for quarterly, or got data for annually, semi-annually, and so on. So it's very important analysis in financial research. Health research, right? The health status of individuals or populations, that also can be done using panel data analysis. I hope you have enjoyed this video. If you have enjoyed, please share with your friends. Please let us know how you found this video in the comment section. Thank you so much. Please subscribe to our channel if you haven't subscribed yet. And please also visit our website in the description section. Please also support us on Patreon. You can go to the homepage of our website. You can also get the link to the Patreon in the description section. So thank you so much.